Yes. Hello and welcome to a brand new episode of the podcast entitled Couch Potatoes Unite! Exclamation point, which is based on a blog of the same name because, well, we just want to reiterate that we are potatoes specifically, and not yams, for the record. And therefore, are probably not best for making organic lube. Just saying. My name is Kylie, and I love TV. If you feel the same, keep listening and or checking out our website, couchpotatosunite.wordpress.com, as you're bound to find some common ground or something you like. For Couch Potatoes Unite, we're all about the wonders and the unique long-form storytelling of the small screen. CPU hopes you've been following releases of brand new episodes of the podcast on Wednesdays, as well as new blog entries on some Tuesdays. And as always, we have several more new episodes on the way. Because the panelists and I live lives behind our podcast, the episodes are published once per week. Subscribe to the blog or the podcast via iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and via Google Play to stay on top of brand new episodes. Episodes already published discuss a variety of shows around the water cooler, including but not limited to Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., New Girl, The Vampire Diaries, The Originals, Orange is the New Black, The X-Files, Supernatural, Gotham, Once Upon a Time, The Good Place, and the DC Television Universe, or Arrowverse, on the CW. Plus, new episodes are in the works, including revisits for The 100, Doctor Who, Game of Thrones, Stranger Things, American Horror Story, Fuller House, How to Get Away with Murder, A Series of Unfortunate Events, and the Marvel's Defenders panel will talk Season 2 of Jessica Jones. A final visit with our Broadchurch panel, I promise it's coming, to say goodbye to the mystery drama from across the pond. We'll be launching new panels covering Sense8, iZombie, The Crown, Schitt's Creek, and Will and Grace. And because we look back at shows now past, we'll be looking back at one of our most popularly requested panels of all time, which is Friends, as well as a one-and-gone series called Battle Creek. By the way, did you know that CPU also from time to time goes live? We've been live from the Bunker, Comedy Outlet Mondays at Dog Story Theater and Grand Rapids Comic Con. And we're planning more live appearances and other cool stuff, so make sure you like us or follow us at our Facebook page, our Twitter at CPU Podcast, our Instagram at Couch Potatoes Unite, and or our Pinterest at CPU Podcast, or subscribe to the blog, our YouTube channel, our iTunes channel, our Stitcher Radio channel, or find us on Google Play. In the meantime, if you don't tier your show in this podcast format, fellow panelists and I still write reviews and we always seek new panelists. So if you have any interest in joining the discussion, say hello by finding us at any of those outlets I've mentioned. At the very least, stop by and leave us a thumbs up, comment, or review. We like feedback, though we'd prefer it if you'd follow Saul and Frankie's example in the feedback department, maybe rather than Grace's. It's probably the hippie in us, maybe. I don't know. Today, we're around the water cooler and taking a first look at the first two seasons of a Netflix situation comedy focused on growing old gracefully, named Grace and Frankie. This is part of a two-part miniseries in which CPU catches up on this quirky comedy. In this episode, part one of the miniseries, we're discussing season one, which was released in its entirety to the Netflix streaming library on May 8, 2015, and season two, which was released in its entirety to Netflix on May 6, 2016, each with a total of 13 episodes, which means, for the record, that the show was legally available to Netflix subscribers exclusively, as it is Netflix-produced original content. We will discuss seasons 3 and 4 in a subsequent episode. Grace and Frankie is an American comedy-drama web television series created by Marta Kaufman and Howard J. Morris for Netflix. The series stars Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin in the title roles of Grace and Frankie, two unlikely friends who are brought together after their husbands announce that they are in love and plan to get married. Sam Waterston, Martin Sheen, Brooklyn Decker, Ethan Embry, June Diane Raphael, and Baron Vaughn co-star in supporting roles. The series follows Grace, a retired cosmetics mogul, and Frankie, a hippie art teacher, whose husbands, Robert and Saul, are successful divorce lawyers in San Diego. Grace and Frankie's lives are turned upside down when Robert and Saul announce that they are in love with each other and are leaving their wives. Now, the women, who have never particularly liked each other, are forced to live together and learn to unite and cope with the difficulties. Despite mixed reviews upon its debut, the series was met with a more positive critical reception toward its later seasons and has received several nominations, including 4 Primetime Emmy Award nominations for Outstanding Lead Actress in a Comedy Series and a Golden Globe Award nomination for Best Actress in a Television Series, Musical, or Comedy. On February 15, 2018, Grace and Frankie was renewed for a 5th season. Grace and Frankie is an unusual selection for the CPU podcast, particularly since the 5 you hear on the panel today include 4 frequent panelists and 1 very involved moderator, none of whom are likely in the target audience for the show. Yet there is a lot to smile about for all viewers, which is why our panel is raring and ready to react to Grace and Frankie. Thus, as always, it should be noted that all of our panelists have watched all episodes of all available seasons of this program to date and may discuss sensitive plot points, which actually exists in this sitcom, miraculously though that might be. So for those of you who have not watched any of Grace and Frankie and plan to do so at some point, listen at your own risk, as there may be major spoilers. At this time, I would like to introduce the panel. All of our panels are familiar with how this works, but I will refresh them and you by saying the following. What I'd like you to do is identify yourself by your first name, just your first name. Don't tell us your story, just your name. And then tell us how you came to watch Grace and Frankie. What made you start watching? How'd you find out about it? What kept you watching? And then, of course, I'm going to have you rate your interest in Grace and Frankie with this standard CPU character question, which changes with each show we do. Are you ready, panel?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
Awesome. And I should let the listener know that we're trying our all-online format again. So if there's weird sound things, that's what it is. I try. But we liked it so much on our Once Upon a Time panel, listen if you like that show, that we're trying it again. So how would you rate your interest in Grace and Frankie? Now, you can kind of focus this after seasons 1 and 2, or you can just talk in general. That's up to you. But how would you rate your interest? Do you, or how you, or this is weird. This is a weird transition, so I'll just launch into it. What can you say? You're ecstatic about everything this show has to offer. It's given you a new lease on life, and you're ready to sing your happiness and joy for this show to the rooftops. In fact, it makes you feel free as nothing has in years, like Robert Hansen. Do you really love it, but you feel guilty for doing so? You know it's not your family's and even some of your friends' cup of tea, but it makes you happier than you've been in years, and you believe that your loved ones will watch it and will come around to your way of thinking once they properly express their feelings in a healthy, constructive way, that is, like Saul Bergstein. You have so many feelings about this show. You're up, you're down, you're high, you're hiding from earthquakes, because this show about septuagenarians is so wonderfully new and exciting. Whatever you are, this show is nothing like you've ever seen before, and it leaves you with so many feelings. Though you do relate to the times at which it is prone to melodrama for laughs, like Frankie Bergstein. It's messed up in all sorts of ways, but you're willing to go with it because that's what a cool, hip, young business owner has to do nowadays. Besides, you like more of it than you care to admit, especially Frankie, because she's like your coolest aunt, like Brianna Hansen. You did not like it or anything about it at first until you became accustomed to the situations being portrayed. You then started to relax and found the show to be not half bad or not as bad as you thought it might be after all. In fact, it's become a great comfort to you in times of stress and emotional peril, like Grace Hansen. Do you think it's all right as things go, but really you're spending most of your time trying not to fall off the wagon, and as such you aren't so apt to pay attention to what's going on, particularly with the show, like Coyote Bergstein. Do you dutifully watch it because your family watches it? However, the show is deeply flawed to you, and you're mostly only going along with it because that's what you have to do out of loyalty to your family, like Nwabudike or Bud Bergstein. Or you don't like it. You can't deal with it. Everything is drama and weird. The alcoholic character is creepy while complicatedly attractive, and the adjustment to two gay fathers leaves you squeamish. And you're really just trying to do the best you can with what you've got as far as this show is concerned, if you even know yourself. Like Mallory Hansen, who would like to start?
Hi, I'm Krista.
Hi, Krista.
I started watching this show immediately as soon as it was released on Netflix for season one because Lily Tomlin. Because I love Lily Tomlin and everything she does. And so when I saw the trailer on Netflix, I was super excited and watched it all right away. I don't think there's actually been a season of this show that I haven't just started binge watching the second it dropped. So I think I'm kind of a weird mix between Robert and Brianna.
Okay.
Because I relate to Brianna as a character more than any character in television. I really think we'd be friends. But if I'm having a crappy day or something, this is one of those shows that I'll go back to and just, I'll go back and I'll rewatch, and it tends to brighten my spirits, as it were. So I'm not quite singing from the rooftops, but
okay. Do you think it's messed up in all sorts of ways, but you're willing to go with it? Because that's what a cool, hip, young business owner has to do? Or are you dropping that part off?
I'm dropping that part off.
Okay.
I'm combining the best parts of both of them.
I see. Okay, fair enough. Well, welcome back, Krista.
This is Amie.
Hi, and Amie.
I'm super excited. Hi. Super excited to talk about this show. So I think of the rating system we have in place at the moment, I probably am closely Frankie Bergstein. I think I love the show. Although I probably can't relate to it generationally, there are other things that I can relate to. I think it's funny. I think it's fresh. Yeah, there's nothing about it that I don't really like. I don't have people in my life who disapprove of it or anything like that. So I will say my rating scale is Frankie.
How did you find Grace and Frankie? What made you start watching? Oh. How did you find out about it? What kept you watching?
You know what? I think I honestly can't remember how I started watching it. I think it was something that I knew was coming out. A lot of people were watching it and I jumped on and, I watched the first episode and it catches you. I mean, it just like brings you in, easily bingeable. And then, of course, I had to keep watching it because and we'll talk about this, the end of every season, there's some sort of cliffhanger. It leaves you wanting more because it's so engaging. At least it did for me. I love it. I mean, I started watching it right away, and I've watched every single season. Like Krista, as soon as it's dropped, I've watched it.
Thanks, Amie.
Hi, I'm Kristen.
Hi, Kristen.
Hi. So, like the other girls, I found out about Grace and Frankie because I saw the advertisements on Netflix as I was logging in, and it's Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin. Like, how would you not want to check that out? So I definitely kept it on my radar, and I started watching right when the episodes were released, and I kind of binged it, like, in one weekend. Really, really liked it, and it was just funny, so that's why I stayed watching. And I think as far as the rating scale goes, I am a Frankie, even though Frankie and I are total opposites in real life. But I love this show. I think it's great. There's the melodrama for laughs. It's new. It's exciting. It's a wonderful comedy starring two just old broads. I love it. So yeah, I am Frankie in this sense.
So A, congratulations on just picking one. And two, are you saying if you're the opposite of Frankie, does that make you a Grace in real life?
I think in real life, I'm probably closer to Grace.
Okay.
I don't know. You guys know me pretty well. I don't know if I'm really a Frankie. I'm not a hippie like Frankie, but she's fun. She'd be my favorite aunt if she were a member of my family.
All right. Welcome back, Kristen.
Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Samantha. Like everyone else, I had a Netflix account, and of course it was advertised to me, and the four main stars, because I love them so much, made me want to check it out. Although I watched the first episode, and it was so painfully awkward that I started as a Mallory. I don't understand why everyone likes this show. Walked away from it for about a year before I thought, I really love all of these actors. I have to give it another chance. So I think maybe it was just a frame of mind that I had at the time, but I gave it another try and quickly became a Frankie and love it.
All right. Welcome back, Samantha. So all of these panelists have been on some of our other panels. Kristen, if you've listened to CPU, you've heard her voice. Amie's on like our Once Upon a Time panel is one of her big ones. And probably this one will be a big one for her. Krista's been on quite a few, including our Downton Abbey and our, what else have you done, Krista? Gilmore Girls, because Samantha's also done Gilmore Girls. And then Broadchurch, Orange is the New Black. If you've listened to CPU, chances are you will have heard them. There's something, everybody's got a variety of tastes, so that's what's fun about bringing these panels together. And of course, my name is Kylie. I am moderating as well as participating today, as I've said. I came to watch Grace and Frankie basically because Krista and Kristen in short succession both said to me, I think we should do Grace and Frankie on CPU. I like this show. You should watch Grace and Frankie. And then other people like Amie started talking about Grace and Frankie. And it just sort of snowballed from there. So I was like, okay. And the way it happened was there was enough interest that I thought, I'm going to give this show a try. Let's see if we'll make it a panel. And as it turns out, it is charming. It's cute. It's funny. I want Lily Tomlin to be my best friend. I keep saying that. I've always thought that, not just on this show. And I just really enjoy it. It's very poignant comedy. It is unusual in the sense that it does focus on sort of older generations, if you will, but it does doesn't neglect the younger ones or vice versa. There's a lot of relevant social commentary that they're tackling, while at the same time, there are so many funny situations that you can't help but laugh or question, do these things really happen in real life for real? So it's so extremely funny, and I just kept watching because it was really easy to do so. As such, I would rate myself a Frankie. I have so many feelings about this show, and I love how it's melodramatic for the sake of funny. I just like it, and I think that I was like Brianna because I sort of relate to her, and I do think it can be occasionally messed up. But I'm willing to go with it because it's pretty fun. It's a fun show, ultimately. So thanks, everybody, for joining us today. Now, because we're taking a first look, we have to do the star rating scale, which is doesn't change with each show we do. My sister calls it the star business. Basically, this is how it goes. We're going to go around the water cooler, virtual though it may be today, and I'm going to have you rate your feelings about the show overall according to this highly scientific, totally detailed star rating scale. And it goes like this. Would you rate Grace and Frankie 5 stars? Holy smokes, it's the greatest thing since sliced bread. You have to watch everything. It's the funniest thing you've seen since the last funny thing you've seen. You just have to rate it 5 stars. Is it 4 stars? It certainly seems intriguing. You're going to keep watching, but you see some possible pitfalls on the premise. Is it 3 stars? You're going to give it 1 more try. There are things you like, things you don't. You want to see which things are allowed to flourish. Is it 2 stars? You've maybe only watched part of it, or maybe 1 season. Chances are you're mainly bored. There's some intrigue or fascination that might hold it together, but you're really finding it hard to convince yourself to keep watching. Or is it 1 star? Pass on this one, guys. It's a snoozer. It's not funny. It's not interesting. It's not your cup of tea. It's about things you just don't relate to. There are too many options to waste time on this Grace and Frankie show. 1 star. Who would like to start?
I give it a solid 4. I like it. It's very funny. Some episodes are more interesting than others. It's not my favorite comedy that's out there right now, but it's definitely towards the top of my list, or the top half of my list. So yeah, solid 4.
I give it a 4.5. If I'm basing it just on season 1 and 2, which this episode is about, then I would say I love it. I want to watch everything, but I think it veers a little bit into 4 because of the reasons there. It's intriguing, possible pitfalls in the premise, but based on season 1 and 2, 4.5.
I'd give a solid 4, and I'd be prepared to give it a 5, except for some of the uncomfortable episodes and awkward episodes just of the guys coming out and then the women having to deal with that.
I would also give it a 4, especially season 1 wasn't my most favorite. Yeah, I would go see a solid 4 just because some of the episodes, especially those early ones, were a little messy.
I would also rate it a 4. I think people are pretty much encapsulating my thoughts about it. It definitely gets better later on. It's funny in the first season, but there's definitely a point at which the whole cast sort of clicks and reaches a stride, and then it's just funny from then on out. Though I also agree with Kristen's comment, some of the situations are funnier than others. Some are laugh out loud funny, you can't even believe you're watching it. And then some of them are, you know, they make you smile, but they might be kind of a little on the boring side. So I think that is the trend that they have established and that they have kept going with. And we'll kind of talk about that as we talk about all the seasons. So I think 4 is a pretty fair rating. And sounds like pretty universal, but for the 0.5 from Amie. So now let's talk about season 1. In our episode today, we're going to talk about the first 2 seasons, and we'll go in turn. And in season 1, we'll start. This is basically the season, as a couple have said, that the guys come out. They've admitted that they've been having an affair with each other for 20 years, even though they're partners at a law firm as well. The wives have no idea. Grace and Frankie are completely opposite from each other in all ways, shapes, and forms. And as a way to cope, essentially, they decide to live together in a jointly owned beach house because these families have been interrelating for decades because of the close work relationship unbeknownst to them about the rest of it. So what did you think about season one? What did you like? What didn't you like? Let's start with that same old question.
So as I mentioned before, I didn't like it straight away just because that first episode or two was just sort of painful to watch them go through that shock and Grace and Frankie's, you know, just inherent hatred toward each other up to that point. But for me, it really started to click and grow when their banter went from a hateful banter towards each other to a really genuine, we get each other, we're actually friends, we admire each other, but we're still gonna get our jabs in. But it was in more of a playful, fun way than a, oh my God, you annoy me, to no end way.
Yeah, I think it kind of became, for me, it switched to the episodes where they cut off their credit cards, where it went from, okay, these two are, like, not meshing, to becoming kind of, and that's when, like, the Saul and Robert versus Grace and Frankie thing kind of started, which did get sorted out, but it added an element of tension that was really nice. And I think that's also the episode where we met the kids, which are kind of the best part of the show, at least early on.
Yeah, I'll agree with that. I would say the first three episodes are probably the most awkward of the series in general, just because someone else had mentioned they're still trying to find their footing. You know, we're still being introduced to the characters because the kids come in a little while later. But I think once we get through that funeral of Robert and Saul's, like, old boss or business partner at the law firm, then I think that's where it picks up. The cast has really started to gel. The kids are in this series a little bit more than they were at the outset. And like Samantha said, their jabs go from more, I really don't like you, to, okay, we're best friends now, and this is our relationship.
I think that it's interesting, because I don't disagree with what everybody has said. I feel like I was more uncomfortable with the first couple of episodes because, again, I think it goes back to the actors not quite gelling, maybe not quite comfortable yet with what they were portraying. I mean, we're talking about some of really solid actors here. But I wasn't as uncomfortable maybe as some others were, but as far as me kind of warming up to them warming up to the to actually telling this story, it was a little weird the first couple of episodes. I'm glad that I was able to push past that though. But it is awkward though. So I think it's entirely appropriate for us to feel that way in many ways, because the situation itself is not supposed to be comfortable.
That's a good point, and I agree with Amie's take on it. I think that in some ways, you know, the ensemble hadn't gelled yet, so there is kind of that sort of tiptoeing to get comfortable feeling in the show in those first three episodes, though I get why other people have responded that, you know, maybe it was a little bit more awkward than they would have liked, but I think that awkwardness was partially deliberate. I mean, we're talking about a situation where you have people that have known each other for such a long time and they're being upended. I also think they were trying to really capitalize on, I mean, Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin are buds and co-stars from way back. We should mention, amongst other vehicles, they were in things like 9 to 5. So these two actresses know each other very, very well and are not playing characters that are too far off who they are in actual real life. So it was really just trying to translate those parts of themselves into the performances and the situations that they're given. I would like to explore Krista's comment a little bit more. She says, the kids are in some ways the best part of the show. How do other people feel about the kids? Brianna and Mallory from the one family, and then Coyote and Bud from the other.
I'll be honest. I completely disagree with that. I think that the first couple of seasons, they were insanely unlikable. And I could not stand them, and I couldn't understand why they were really even portrayed that way. I've warmed up to them since, but I could just have done without them in that first season. It took me a long time to warm up to them. And maybe it was character development, story development, or something, but I didn't find them very, very likable for myself. And maybe that was the point, I don't know.
At least for me, the kids have always been an awkward part of the show because it's not consistent of how much into their backstories they go, where it seems like they'll have made a lot of progress, almost have time jumped between episodes, and we don't get to necessarily see that progression. So sometimes I feel like I'm always racing to catch up to what's happening with them, and as actors and characters, like, they're completely on board with where they are, but I haven't seen that development happen as a viewer.
I like the kids. Is it Mallory, the older blonde one who runs Grace?
Brianna.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Brianna rubbed me the wrong way for quite a while. Mallory was just kind of hanging out. And then Bud and Coyote were probably my top two favorite of the kids for a while. But I think as season one kind of progressed and as we got more into season two, I really started to like seeing the kids a lot more. It was kind of interesting to get into how this is affecting their lives and seeing the whole family interact. I really enjoyed that. But I really like Ethan Embry, who plays Coyote. So I may be a little biased because of that, too.
Well, he's adorable.
He is very much adorable. And I love him as this character. I think it's a perfect fit. And the guy who plays Bud, I absolutely love. He's so funny, even when he is playing straight man to a lot of the jokes.
I was going to say that as well. I like Coyote and Bud probably more than the girls. Coyote's story is a little wonky just because he's recovering. I think that his story takes a little bit more of a convincing leap in the third and fourth season, which we'll talk about. Bud, I agree. I love him as sort of the eternal straight man. I think that works for that actor. I think that works when in later seasons again, when he becomes involved, and we'll talk about that. Brianna, I do like Brianna. I think she's meant to be grating. I think that's her whole design. It takes the most after her mother. And so I connect that pretty easily, but I also find it interesting that not only does she take after her mom, she butts heads with her the most, and then also gravitates to Frankie because of that. And there are times, and I think there's one episode in this season, because we're doing the whole online dating profile business for Grace, you know, Brianna's going to help her do that, and then she ends up smoking weed on the couch with Frankie for most of the episode until they run off and get froyo, okay? And then Grace breaks her hip. It's a whole thing. And so I think Brianna is complicated, and so I'm along for her ride because I think she represents a woman that maybe I see a little bit of myself in. Mallory is the one that I struggle with the most. And maybe it's because I don't relate to her situation, but I also find, especially in the first season, she's the whiniest. She reacts the poorest to the situation. She's got her really off. She feels like a trope because she's got, you know, a loveless marriage with a super hot guy. She hasn't really found herself. I don't know that I care about her story at all. And then they keep hinting back and forth at this past incident that Coyote got really drunk and I guess professed his love to the rooftops for her, but they never really take the time to explain that incident. So I find that she becomes more of a device than being an actual character. So I don't like her that much. That's how I feel about the kids. Any of the situations or episodes in the first season that you really enjoyed or really didn't enjoy? And we should mention that, you know, we start to introduce love interests aside outside of the gay couple. We start to introduce love interests, and the one in this season particularly is Guy, who dates Grace, and he is played by Craig T. Nelson, who most people know as Coach.
And who was on Parenthood.
Oh, that's right.
Slightly younger viewers. He was Zeke on Parenthood.
Yes, slightly younger viewers. Thanks, Kristen.
I know. Yes, I watched Coach with my parents growing up, but I didn't. I was like, oh, it's that guy who, you know, who's on Coach. He's now on Parenthood. This is cool.
Okay. So, yeah. Craig T. Nelson, what'd you think?
Craig T. Nelson.
Yeah.
Kylie, if it makes you feel better, I know him as Coach first, too.
Okay. A little bit.
My take on Guy is that I couldn't stand him initially, and he got worse. I couldn't wait for her to break it off with him. There was nothing about that I liked.
Oh, okay.
It was a nice, like, rebound for her, but I have liked some of the guys that she's been with since a lot more than Guy, but I kind of agree with Samantha. I liked him, but he wasn't like, oh, I want them to be together. It was, okay, this is who she's going to be with for a while, and then we'll go off to somebody else.
Yeah, yes. She'll most definitely move on.
Yeah.
He was a good rebound. He was a good first step, but not much more.
Yeah, I didn't have a huge opinion about that relationship. I just didn't think it was going to last either. I thought it was a nice ease out of or in, you know, into this new life and out of, like, being, like, a depressed divorcee or whatever. I'm with the others. Like, it was fine, I guess. But I liked some of the other people a little better. Like, I'm glad it wasn't a long-term thing.
Yeah, I would agree with that take. I don't have any strong feelings about it. I think Craig T. Nelson was a good sport for playing the character. It's a little bit against his type, which I think was fun as well. And then we also meet, for the first time in this season, though they don't start anything yet, Jacob, who's played by Ernie Hudson, who's most famously Winston in the Ghostbusters movies.
Woo! I love him. I was so happy to see him.
Oh, I was so excited, too. I was like,
all right. Yeah, I loved his relationship with Frankie. It was awesome in this first season.
I have to agree with that. It was really, I was excited to see him, and I thought he worked really well. And I still think he, well, we'll talk about that later, but I'm glad that he's on the show.
Same.
So let's talk about, the first season was really about Robert and Saul adjusting into their newfound freedom as an out and proud couple.
And then the same for Grace and Frankie, adjusting.
Right.
Season 1 was just all adjusting.
Right, everybody was adjusting. Though not, the women were not an out and proud couple, just to be fair. Connect those references.
That would be an interesting twist, though.
Maybe. I don't know if we could get there with the way their personalities work.
No, I don't want to see that.
No, I would stop watching because it's just
It's okay. Everything is fine. You can make a joke. So what do you think about it?
Think about season one in general?
Or just about the progression of the two husbands that become each other's husbands, but not till season two.
Oh, gotcha. Well, I feel like it was pretty realistic because they really care about each other, but they make this giant leap. And then after they get past telling the ladies and then being together, they sort of have this moment or lots of moments of now what? And how do we actually do this not in secret? And I feel like that's very realistic to the real world.
Yeah, they're kind of finding their footing a little bit on this new path that they've set out on together.
And I agree. And I think that it also gave a really important voice to that experience, because that's not something that doesn't necessarily happen. Like, that has happened for people, whether it's men or women. And whether, I think between the demographic they're trying to go for, or they're targeting with the show, and then the subject matter, I think that combined, it's a unique presentation of a comedy. I just think it is a little awkward at first, but in a really important and refreshing way, I guess. I think the whole now what and what do we do and how do we respond and how do we relate to our exes, I think that's all just brilliant. I think I'm really glad that they're exploring that.
And a big piece for me, I actually, more recently, I was listening to an interview that Jane Fonda gave of how, after that first season premiered, they were so surprised at how it resonated with younger viewers, too, because they hadn't expected that. But I think that lends itself to, it's not just an age issue. What they're going through happens at literally every point in your life, or can happen at every point in your life. So it's very realistic.
I agree with all that. That's great. What about the cosmetics business, the Say Grace business, that first starts as Grace's and then she steps aside and lets Brianna run it? She tries to come back for a minute, but Say Grace's was Grace's former life at some point, and she tried to make it her own again, but didn't. But yet it's still a pretty prominent part of the story.
I think it's a nice kind of comparison to our four main characters, you know, Grace, Frankie, Saul, and Robert, because, you know, as we go on, you know, Brianna, she's the young blood who's coming in to take over. And, you know, Say Grace has to find its way in the world again, too. You know, I mean, so much is happening just in the real world with, you know, the tried and true brands are disappearing because of new trends and the younger shopper. And, you know, we kind of see over the course of a little bit of season one and two, and we'll get more into it in season three and four, of just how Say Grace is struggling to stay relevant and kind of rebrand itself. Just like, you know, our main characters kind of have to rebrand themselves and their new life a little bit, too.
One of my favorite episodes of season one, other than the bachelor party, is the elevator, where they get, when they get stuck in the elevator after the divorce hearing, as kind of the throwback one, and we see how Brianna what kind of took over, say, Grace, or how Grace decided that she could. And she had some line of, ooh, can I be mean? And it speaks so much to that character. I think Brianna had some of the best one-liners in the whole thing, but we've already discussed how I love her. So I think it's a nice dynamic, and it allows them to have a closeness, Grace and Brianna, that might not have really been shown, that they're so alike, but even though they fight, like, they understand each other.
One of the things that one of my favorite episodes, it's not a very plot-advancing episode, but I just giggle so much at the fact that Frankie and Saul, who have kind of the tougher adjustment, because they do genuinely love each other, which I think is another interesting dynamic that's played on the show. You know, Robert and Grace, even though they care about each other, they're not as attached and don't want to be as attached following the breakup of their marriage. But Saul and Frankie find it very hard to sort of separate. And in fact, there are times and points at later in the seasons that they call each other soulmates, even though, you know, Saul's not attracted to her or vice versa anymore. But yet they bond again over watching the National Spelling Bee, of all things and all places.
That is so cute. I love it. It's something that, like, Robert and Grace just don't understand. No. And so that's, like, their thing. I love it.
And I just
thought it was pretty funny.
Yeah. There's one of those situations that just makes me wonder, does this happen in real life? Is this really happening? Well, you know what's also introduced in this season, and we have to mention it, because it spans both seasons? The Yam Lube. Let's talk about the Yam Lube.
Yeah, those yam right. is such a delightful plot point device thing. And it just allows everything to escalate, and they have to talk, and it allows Frankie to talk about lube all the time, which is always enjoyable.
I think that's her favorite word.
Because Grace gets so uncomfortable. It plays out more and more and more as the series progresses, especially there in the beginning when Frankie offers Grace said lube. Yeah, it's a nice moment.
One of my favorite aspects of the Yam Lube, if you can have one of those, is not so much between Grace and Frankie, but Frankie and Jacob, and just how he just gets her and is not surprised at all when she's like, yeah, this is what I'm using your yams for. He's not surprised. He just rolls with it. Just that sort of best friend dynamic that they have from being partners over the years is really funny to me.
I agree. I loved that he was like, okay, you know, I'll supply the yams, you do your thing. Like, I agree with Samantha on that. I really like that.
I think it's hysterical. The fact that it permeates everybody's lives, it's not just Frankie, it's not just Jacob, the lube encroaches on everybody's lives. That spans in the second season, and we'll get into that, but and Yam Lube, of all things. Again, I wonder, does this exist in real life? How did they come up with Yam Lube?
I'm convinced that all things that are in the show is something that someone behind the scenes has experienced either in passing or firsthand, because really, who can make it up?
Yeah, the truth is stranger than fiction.
I just used the Google, and it's super real.
It's super real?
Wild yam cream. It's real.
Cream, but lube is one of its uses?
Farm to vagina. Organic. Wait.
All right, the V word has been said on the podcast.
There's a first time for everything, and we have to blame it on Grace and Frankie. Oh, wow. Although, to be fair, when we recorded yesterday, I said penis, so I think we're just equal opportunity around here.
Yep.
Sounds good.
Thanks. No one else has anything to say about the Yam Lube. Everyone's like, yes, two thumbs up, Yam Lube, great.
I mean, when you think about it, like, of course Frankie's doing that. Of course she's concocted this thing, like, in her studio or her kitchen. Of course. Like, it honestly, it came as no surprise. Oh. I don't know what I was expecting. I wasn't expecting that, but it's like, this makes perfect sense.
Right.
We're just going to roll with this.
Yeah, it wasn't shocking. It was just like, yep, she said that.
Yep.
Carry on.
Fair enough.
I'm sending you all the link.
Krista is sending us the link about the Yamlube cream stuff.
I mean, everyone needs to know, I think. Thanks, Google.
In fact, because we're helpful...
Hey, it just popped up. There we are.
It did. And because we're helpful on the CPU podcast, we will include that link in the embedded blog that I post around this episode.
I mean, everyone deserves a good lube. Let's just say that.
Please don't there be any children listening to this podcast right now.
We'll put a disclaimer.
Otherwise, they can have really fun conversations with their parents later.
It'll spark dialogue. Maybe dialogue.
As Oprah says, a teachable moment.
And Oprah is always right. Or mostly.
I digress.
Yeah, that's for a podcast about Oprah, which we don't do, but maybe someday. So, what about, there's a couple other things I want to mention, because I think they're very important before we transition. The first is Frankie's ex-con student that lays a couple on Grace in the kitchen. What did we think about the mysterious rehabilitate, what does she call it? Rehabilitated something?
I forgot what she calls it. I have a friend in that episode, too, and it wasn't that guy.
You have a friend in that episode?
Yeah, my friend Richard. Richard Azurdia is in that episode.
He plays one of the reformed convicts?
Yeah, he does.
He's That's amazing.
Tell him we'll interview him.
I will. I'll ask him.
All right. Cool.
I thought that that scene that you're referring to is pretty funny.
Okay.
That's all I've got. I had nothing else to say. You were just saying, how do we feel about it?
It's true.
It was funny, like it, but it wasn't a huge deal in the long run, I guess.
For me, it felt like more of just a plot device to break up her and Guy at some point.
But you wanted that.
Well, I did. I mean, I'll admit it, that's fine, you know? But at the same time, when it happened, I was like, that's kind of weird. It just didn't seem like it fit.
Well, there's particularly one episode that I really want to hit on, which is the one before the season finale. So in this penultimate episode of season one, Coyote and Bud are tasked with planning Robert and Saul's bachelor party, and they enlist the help of the girls. But in the meantime, Grace and Frankie go on a yes night. What do we
that
think?
Is my favorite part ever.
Oh my god, is this the night where they dance on the bar?
Yes.
Like, yes.
Yes.
And they dress each other.
Yeah, they dress each other and they're dancing on the bar. Love it.
Isn't their car get stolen?
Yes. Frankie's car gets stolen.
Yeah. And that moment where they're just sitting on the sidewalk trying to get a Lyft or an Uber or something and just being like, what happened? Like, is this our life now? It's just so funny to me.
What, remind me, what was the inflatable blow-up situation? What was it? Was it that they ended up having on the lawn?
Pretty sure that was a penis.
Yeah.
It was a penis?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. That's 2 days in a row there, Kylie.
Yay! We're meeting in some quota.
Does that make us PG-13 now?
Well, we've had a few other words said that probably are hedging us in that direction. Though not the F-bomb. I do edit those out because we're trying That's to good. Keep it family friendly. Yeah, I don't remember who put the penis thing out on the lawn.
Brianna.
I think it was Brianna.
Yeah,
yeah.
Because
that
the party
tracks.
Was not exciting or interesting.
The party was very clean cut and like, because Mallory planned it and it was just like snacks and wine and things, which isn't exactly what they were hoping for. The boys, anyway.
Well, and that whole, at least until it went into true bachelor party territory, I think was very much a microcosm of what their life was like before they came out. If we're going to be prim and proper and everything's buttoned up and we're not going to just have fun and do whatever we want to do.
Yeah, that was definitely Robert and Grace's life.
For sure. Well, I also think Brianna thought that's probably what two gay dads would want, was the penis on the lawn. Just because that's kind of how she rolls, so.
Because that's what she would want.
Right. Exactly. So the cliffhanger on season one is that now that Robert and Saul are engaged to be married, Saul and Frankie go to clean out their old house because Robert and Saul are getting ready to buy their own, and the nostalgia overtakes them so much that they end up sleeping together. Frankie tells Grace, and Grace is furious with Saul and basically tells Saul to go tell Robert because you can't enter a marriage like that. And in the meantime, she breaks up with Guy because she's taking some of her own advice. And the real cliffhanger is Saul goes home to Robert but doesn't tell Robert yet about the tryst. What did we think?
I think it was understandable. I think it's more complicated than they just let together. I think it's a substantially more, you know, complex situation. And where, I mean, I don't condone cheating, of course, but it's understandable.
I think what's understandable is like you said, it's complicated. It kind of, it's not just with anybody. It's with his ex or soon to be ex or whatever she was at that point. And it's like, no, this is not okay. Just because you used to be married and you're not yet married to somebody else. Like, it's just, there's so many layers in there. It's not, it's a gray area, but it's a really, really gray area when it probably shouldn't be very much. So, you know, it's realistic to me that he would have a hard time and not say anything right away.
Well, and I think it goes back to, I believe it was Kristen who had mentioned how different Frankie and Saul were compared to Grace and Robert, in that they still genuinely love each other and there's that connection there. So it wasn't completely surprising to me that it happened, even though it's still not right.
It was sympathetic, if nothing else. I historically have judged characters who would have done something like this in other shows, but I didn't really judge these two in the same way.
Yeah, that's fair. I agree with that. I agree with really everything that's been said. I mean, it's not simple. It's not an easy situation. And I agree with Krista. Like, I didn't judge either character. I judged Saul a little bit in the sense that he hesitated for so long to tell Robert. And now there are complicating factors in the second season, which we'll get to. But ultimately, it's an interesting situation where he can be more honest with Frankie to start than he can with Robert, despite the fact that Robert is the one that he feels, you know, that he's in love with.
Yeah, I don't have anything else to add. You guys already kind of hit everything I was going to say, so.
Fair enough.
I'm good.
Okay. Anything else you want to say about season one before we move on? All right.
Season one was good, but okay. Season two was better.
All right. Well, that's a nice segue. So season two. In season two, they try to basically bring the Yam Lube to market. Say Grace is supposed to distribute the Yam Lube at Brianna's possible testing of that. Robert starts the season with a heart attack, which kind of is the complicating factor I was alluding to just a second ago. This leads to a rushed wedding before the secret of Saul and Frankie's tryst is shared. In the meantime, we have some of the stuff going on with the other kids, though I would say that Brianna's probably more in focus in this season than any of the other three kids. So what did you think about season two? What'd you like? What didn't you like?
It really picked up. It picked up in a very nice way. I was looking through the episode list of season two, and I think I enjoyed every single one of them. And would rewatch, especially the ones with Phil.
Phil, played by Sam Elliott.
Oh, Phil. I loved Phil and Grace.
I love Phil. He is officially a silver fox, can you say that?
Yeah, oh, he's been a silver fox since way back.
Yep.
Okay. And I'm making sure I'm not the only one that was like, kind of an attractive woman.
Yeah. Sam Elliott currently appears on another Netflix show, The Ranch, which is under a bit of controversy right now because one of its stars got booted.
And then recently replaced.
But he plays the patriarch on that. Ashton Kutcher's dad. Ashton Kutcher is star and producer of that show. I don't know if I'd recommend it, and I tried to put it out for CPU talk, but nobody wanted to talk about it. So if you're interested in talking about The Ranch, please contact CPU. But in the meantime, yes, Sam Elliott. He's doing some cross-Netflix purposes. What else did you think?
This is where we meet, is it Barry, the accountant for Brianna?
It sure is.
We met him last season one, technically, at the end, but he really picked up in this season.
Yeah, I really like how cute they are together in this season.
Yes.
So they're like keeping their relationship secret because he's their accountant and she's the boss. And I think he humanizes Brianna a little bit in this season. And that's when I kind of started to like her, is when she started her relationship with Barry.
I agree with that. I mean, my answer previously regarding the kids was specifically when they were introduced. But I think the more we learn about them, the more we see them interact with other characters outside of their family, is where I become a little more engaged in who they are as characters and people. And I do think that Barry did a lot of good things for that character and revealed things about Brianna that other characters wouldn't be able to reveal about her because she's so guarded.
Yeah, guarded's a good word for Brianna. She's very guarded.
And really, there's nothing I don't like about Barry. He's just wonderful all around.
Aw. Do you have a small hearts, hearts, hearts for him or what?
Yeah, I could say some hearts, hearts, hearts.
Okay.
Heart eye emojis on top of that.
Fair enough. I like to bring that out into a podcast from time to time, as some on this panel know. But yes, the Sam Elliott character, Phil. So what we know about Phil is that Grace knew him from before. He was a contractor or something that helped with their house, and they hit it off. She was still married, so she didn't pursue it, even though she knew she was growing distant from Robert and couldn't pin why that was happening. And also, she does make a point in this season and in others, the Grace character, of talking about how there was never really any passion with Robert. She just thought that's how it was until she met Phil. But we also find out about Phil's own life later on, which is that his wife has some sort of degenerative disorder, like Alzheimer's, I think it is. And that complicates things. So what did we think about that reveal?
That was really bad.
Yeah, it made me sad, too. I was disappointed.
Yeah, I really wanted them to get together. And I know, like, Grace was so close to making that leap this time. And then, you know, the conversation of, well, my wife is still, we're still legally married, even though she's really no longer my wife and hasn't been for a while. It just kind of ripped your heart out.
My biggest complaint about it is the way it kind of ends and how they don't really come back to it in a meaningful way. I mean, she drives off and they agree, yes, it's hard, everything is hard, but, and I think this is covered in season 3, but Phil ends up dying off screen. So I don't know how I feel about the exploration of this particular relationship, except for the fact that Phil's, you know, really, really, really handsome. And there is that.
Well, I mean, they do hook up, but they do. Then Grace realizes she can't do that, really. Like, it's, she can't be the other woman, I guess, as it were. In real life, that's how things end. People just go away and you never see them again.
I guess, but that one seemed a little bit more meaningful. And I guess if they were going to talk about him dying off screen, it would have been better to not know that he died and just left. You know what I mean?
I disagree. I thought that was in it, which we'll talk about when we get there in season 4, but I think that was a big moment for Grace to make some important decisions.
Oh.
And that kind of helped kick her in the butt.
Yeah, I kind of, and again, like she said, we'll talk about it when we get to that episode, but I do think that there was a reason for it, that it was important to the future storylines and plot points and story development. So we'll talk about it, but yeah, it did make me sad to hear that, but in the scheme of the storyline, I thought it was important.
Well, I don't like that it was necessarily just dropped, but am I the only one who thinks that he's actually not dead?
I guess I didn't think about that.
I don't see why they would trick us with that, though.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you just hopeful?
No, it seemed like it came out of left field so much that I thought, well, what if there's another guy named Phil who happened to be in construction?
I mean, and Phil is
a good name. Like,
they
used odd encounter.
They used his picture.
Did they?
Oh, I missed that. Oh, man, I've been holding out this whole time.
Yeah, I think there was an obituary, like, she looked it up.
Yeah. I didn't get this. Oh, I didn't.
Then I'm most definitely wrong about that, then.
Yeah. I didn't get the sense there was a chance he was coming back when it happened, and that's why I kind of felt like, okay, but you're right, Krista, it does motivate other things, but I don't know, maybe it could have been handled better in the moment. I just, that moment left me feeling a little bit weird just because of how it started in this season, I think, and I know we're kind of bridging the two seasons right now, but it just, I don't know, I don't mind that he died, I just wish it hadn't have been, oh, he died over here. Here's the obituary. Okay.
Right.
Like, it made sense, because, I mean, it wasn't, like, a complete non-sequitur, because, I mean, she was looking up contractors, but, yeah, no, I get what you're saying.
Yeah. So, and also in this season, so, Grace spends a few episodes coaching that bartender. What did we think about that?
I only liked it because when Grace kind of hit rock bottom, it was at her bar.
It was, okay.
It was kind of, like, not nice, obviously, but storytelling-wise, it was, okay, well, that makes sense. But I didn't like the first episode when she was, like, trying to make her into a little mini-her.
I thought the whole storyline was tedious, actually. It was one of the lower points of the series for me, just because I got that Grace needed a project, but I don't know. It just felt, like, tropey, very tropey.
To be honest, I totally forgot about it until it was brought up again. That's how much it stuck with me.
So I'm so going with, yeah.
Yeah, so didn't care for it, didn't do anything for me.
Yeah, I mean, I think it has something to do with Grace, like, trying to let go. I know there's probably some metaphor in there, but yeah, it was cute for, like, a minute, but it just kind of was unresolved. The girl just decided to stop, and they never really addressed it or picked it back up after that.
Yeah, I would say it's a weak point on the series, personally. But and then, of course, Saul does eventually tell Robert about sleeping with Frankie, and Robert throws him out of the house. And this exists over at least a good chunk of the season. What about that drama?
Their reunion was the sweetest thing, though, with them dancing in the kitchen.
Agreed.
And then the plaster falls on their head.
Yes.
I liked it when the girls discovered Saul sleeping on their porch, their back porch.
I don't know, that felt super hypocritical to me of Robert, for someone who was so sneaky for, what, 20 years?
Yeah.
Really?
Agreed. I reacted much the same way. I'm like, I think you should give him a pass if you want to get the same pass for your own self. And let's just, I mean, I have to say, since we're talking about this portion, you've got four veteran actors and actresses. You've seen them in a bunch of things otherwise. We could rattle off a list. I have to say, even though Martin Sheen does a fabulous job as Robert, there are times when I'm just taken out of it because, you know, he's the president from the West Wing, or he's Apocalypse Now guy, or he's Charlie Sheen's dad, you know? And it's like he's playing this erudite, lovely man who loves, you know, the guy from Law and Order. It's really weird.
I'm like, why is Jed Bartlett suddenly very, you know, afraid of his mother?
Well, you know, I mean,
right.
That's in a later season. I mean, we meet the mother.
Back to what you were, in that respect of what you were just saying there, Kylie, first of all, I think it's a lot of fun to see these actors be this way and to be in community theater and to do all this stuff, but my issue was getting into it the first couple of, maybe the first half of the season, kind of thinking like that, like, is this something I can, like, suspend my disbelief on or whatever? You know, is this going to be something that I can invest in these actors playing these characters? And I could, because they're good actors and the storyline is very good, but that's kind of how I felt the first season. Like, oh my God, how can I take him seriously in this role right now? But it grew on me.
Yeah, I think it gets easier to forget who they are in real life the more you watch it. And the further you progress in the seasons as the characters develop. But I've definitely had that moment multiple times with all four of them because they're so recognizable and so iconic from other areas.
See, and I may be the odd one out. I haven't had that experience, even though I have seen them in a bunch of other things. You know, I like that. You know, the guys are playing something totally different than what they're most famous for. And, you know, the girls, yeah, they're just kind of playing themselves, like a fictionalized version of themselves. But I don't have that, like, I'm being pulled out of the show because they were so-and-so or they've done this. I don't know. I'm weird. It could just be me.
For me, it's not.
You're not weird. You're not weird at all. I think that's good that you can do that.
Yeah,
it's not all the time, but like there, I guess there's just sometimes moments, you know, mannerism-wise. Lily Tomlin is also in the West Wing, so that's a thing. But then, you know, 9 to 5, we can go on.
Yeah, I didn't watch enough of the West Wing to realize that Lily Tomlin was in that one. But that does explain how she might know
Martin Sheen.
And well, and in that, she definitely plays not exactly the same, but with similar. The same sort of skewed personality. At least skewed in the same direction. She's a little unhinged.
Her character is an alpaca farmer in D.C., because that makes sense.
Because Lily Tomlin.
Right.
Because Lily Tomlin. Sure. And didn't she smoke peyote or something before her interview?
Yep.
With the president?
So,
yeah.
Also because Lily Tomlin. But then Jane Fonda and Sam Waterston were both on The Newsroom, which is what I had watched most recently before I started watching Grace and Frankie. And Jane Fonda, of course, always tends to play that very strong woman. So I had that in the back of my mind. But then Sam Waterston is also just so different in this than anything else. I guess Kristen is just much better at viewing and separating show to show than the rest of us.
I can just kind of like disassociate a little bit stronger than everybody else. I don't know.
Well, and to be fair, they're all doing a great job. If they weren't, I don't think we'd want to watch it. But yeah, I think it's just an experience. And I wonder about other viewers and how they feel. You know, we'll kind of talk about this in a little bit. Of course, I'll ask the standard questions about would you recommend this. I've actually tried to rope my mom into watching this because she's watched these actors for forever. And they're in things that she loves decades strong. And I'm like, you have to watch this show. And even she, because she's got so much history with these actors, is like, it is an adjustment. Because of how different they are, but it's also a super fun adjustment, don't get me wrong. But I always think it's very, very funny, and especially Martin Sheen's mannerisms, because he is so typically sort of that strong, quiet, broad, and, you know, manly man kind of a guy, and now he's not doing that at all. So,
which is so fun. It is so fun, though.
It
when
is.
You think about it, you're like, oh my god, okay. This is great. And for me, him in particular, it gets more fun the longer I watch it.
Yeah.
With respect to him as an actor.
Agreed. So the cliffhanger on this season, such as it is, because it's not really a cliffhanger, but there is a very poignant end. I forget what the woman's name is now, and I'm sure it's...
Babe.
Who?
Babe.
No, I know the character. I meant the actress. You didn't let me finish.
Is it Estelle? Am I wrong? What's her name? It's like something like
Estelle sounds right. I can't think of her last name, but she played Roseanne's mom on the original run of Roseanne. She does play Babe. That's the name of the character. Babe is dying from cancer. She's in
Beverly Lorraine Harris.
Oh, Estelle maybe Parsons. That's Estelle Parsons. Okay.
Oh, there you go. So
I got the first name
Roseanne's
right.
Mom. I googled Roseanne's mom.
Oh, good. Oh, that's funny.
Roseanne, so
sure.
What?
You've never seen Roseanne?
I wasn't allowed to watch it when I was a kid.
Oh my god, that's all I watched. And now they rebooted it. But anyway,
I know.
That's, again, a different podcast. I don't even know if it's going to be a podcast, but different discussion.
It's been requested.
Has it? That's hysterical.
I had strict television rules growing up.
Oh.
Wow. Well, okay. Anyway, she plays Babe. She's dying of cancer. She has an advanced stage of cancer. She knows both Grace and Frankie from way back. She comes into town to throw basically a fabulous death party, if you will. She's known for her parties, but this is the party to end all parties. And the biggest piece of this is that she wants Frankie to help euthanize, basically, because she wants to go out on her own terms. And Grace is not comfortable with that at all. That is very much against her grain. However, this whole process leads them to a few very essential life decisions. What did we think about this part of the story?
This is probably one of my top three episodes for the show as a whole. This episode really resonated with me. It was emotional, you know, and I like that they were kind of able to go a little bit more into the more serious side of things. I'm not going to call it dramatic, but they were a little more serious with how they handled this. And I liked that too. So, okay. Yeah. Somebody else talk. I can't keep going. I'll make myself cry.
Oh,
well, it's one of those moments where they balanced funny moments and transitioned very smoothly into something very serious and thought provoking, but then were then able to pull themselves back out of it pretty smoothly too, that I think it could have very easily become a clunky episode. Just because it's such a heavy subject.
I think the way that the character Babe didn't take it seriously was helped give it some levity, that otherwise, if she had been very emotional about it, and we've seen that, it might have been harder as a viewer. I rewatched that episode and the one after it just the other day, and yeah, they're some solid television.
I think that goes back to kind of this particular show tackling certain perspectives that other shows don't tackle in that way. They're using, they're touching on the heartstrings. It's something people deal with, whether you're older and you have a disease, or you just have a disease, and how you say goodbye and how you cope with that. I think it's just, and again, it's a voice and a perspective that other television, at least that I know of, and I don't watch as much as some on this podcast, they don't explore or tell those sides of the stories. I think it was very important, and I think it's another part of why this show, in my mind, is so important. And so just having that, I think, helps people cope. You know, you see that subject matter, but you don't see it in this not dramatic, you don't see it in a tragic way, you know?
Or like a soapy way.
Yeah, you see it it was honest, it wasn't easy on the heart, but it was honest, and it was very touching.
I agree, I loved these episodes. I think this was, even though season two picks up pacing-wise for me, I think of all the seasons, it's the weakest on situations, except for the Sam Elliott appearance, and except for this part of the season. I think that it makes Grace and Frankie confront their own views on where they are, each other's views on where they are, each other as friends, and how they are going to move forward with their life in such a critical way. It almost, in many ways, is kind of a cornerstone for this season. Like, everything builds up to it, so I'm not saying that the rest of it isn't good or doesn't fit, but to me, this is like, these couple of episodes are so much stronger than a lot of what you see up until the point. So I think it's a testament to the writing, and also a testament, again, to the fact that we have some heavy hitters in this cast who can sell it to us. And Estelle, what's her name? Parsons? Estelle Parsons.
Parsons.
Yeah. I mean, there's always going to be sort of a zany part of her that reminds me of Roseanne's mom, but I loved her appearance in this as well. I think she was almost ethereal in the way she portrayed this character, and that's not an easy balance to strike in terms of all of this. So my only thought watching them was, oh, we're talking about euthanasia. I wonder if that's going to be controversial, and I haven't heard any controversy about it whatsoever. Which I think is also interesting.
Well, and I think it's because of the way she portrayed the character of Babe. Okay, I'm not saying this just to say it. She genuinely, and maybe it's just a credit to her acting skills, she was like, this is what I'm doing, this is why, I'm taking it seriously, I'm not trying to escape anything. And then I think the show handled it in a pretty progressive way, too, of having Grace basically freak out, not be okay with it, completely remove herself from the situation, but from a genuine perspective, come to realize, hey, I'm her friend, I have to support her, this is what she wants to do, and come around to that understanding.
Mm-hmm. I loved that moment, too, when she decided, nope, I'm here to support you. They didn't, like, have a big discussion about it. It was just Babe just kind of welcomed her back, and they just kept on going. And that's what kind of got to me, was that moment of Grace making that turn.
Yeah, and it's all in looks.
Yes.
And that's so much more powerful than, it could very easily go into, like, after school special territory.
Yep.
If they were to talk it out.
Very well performed and well directed, I think. Anything else you want to say about season two?
Can I bring up the last episode really fast?
You can do whatever you want, Krista, my dear.
Well, the gift from Babe.
Yes.
The vibrator and then the art show.
Oh, yes. We should mention those.
I mean, they completely launch season three. And then the whole Kenny Loggins thing and Hitler's circumcision. They are, both of them are understandably furious. And then they mic drop with the kids at Bud's birthday.
That's really in season three.
Kind of frivolous.
Are we getting into season three now? Are we talking?
That's the end of season two.
Yeah, the birthday party is in season two, but the art show's in season three. But
wow, they really do blend together.
She gets the postcard from Babe on the last episode of season two.
I remember that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that Babe has, she purchased gallery space for Frankie.
Yep.
Right. And then Grace gets the vibrator and injures herself, and that's how they decide to make vibrators for older women with arthritis, with large print in the direction.
Yes. Amongst other things.
So... Also, was I the only one that was, like, legit infuriated that Robert had, like, a stash of gifts for her with all these notes on them?
Put that out of my mind. Yeah. One of those irritating moments of, like, ugh, that's such a guy thing to do.
It is.
So, yes, that sound exactly.
Yep.
Yeah, like, I understood her being furious, even though everyone else was like, what? What's the big deal?
Well, and... I think for my purposes, of the four adults in the equation, Martin Sheen's Robert, he's the one that I struggle to relate to the absolute most, just because there is a little bit of that obtuseness that runs through his character, not only with Grace, but also with Saul. So it's just what he wears is part of his personality. So yes, it was infuriating, but also not unexpected, I guess.
Oh, no.
Yeah, because Robert, he still has that good old boy mentality underneath it all, where, you know, he's the very 1950s man.
Yeah.
You know, he's the company man, you know.
Yeah, that's kind of his
thing.
I enjoy where season two left us. I thought it set up season three really nicely, and it kind of gave us something for everybody. I love when they're all together, anything when they're all together, all the couples, all the kids, everybody. And ending like that, I thought was really nice.
I agree. I think it's a very strong ensemble, and I do think that of all the cliffhangers, quote-unquote, this is probably the strongest one we've seen, including in the latter two seasons. Anything else?
Season 4 gives it a run for its money, but that's just me.
Okay. Well, we'll debate that when we get to seasons 3 and 4. So I'll use that as a segue. Thanks, Krista. So now I have to ask you these standard questions because we're taking a first look. So, this was co-created by Marta Kaufman and Howard J. Morris. Howard J. Morris created two shows you've probably never heard of that were canceled very quickly. Marta Kaufman, on the other hand, has created quite a few fairly popular shows, but probably the most popular show was Friends. She was the co-creator on Friends, so... What do you think of their collaboration on this? Would you watch, probably the Friends question doesn't even apply, but would you watch any other shows on which they collaborate to create or any they've created individually? Will Grace and Frankie motivate you to do that? Talk to me about that.
I guess I've never really thought about who produces the show and will I watch it because of that, which is maybe bad.
Well, creator is actually writer, head writer. They might produce too, but...
Well, I didn't start...
Retract what I said.
I didn't start watching it because of them. But yeah, I always think about, like, oh, that person did that show. I'll give this one a try, too. So yeah, I think I'd give other shows a try, I guess.
Yeah, when they were advertising Grace and Frankie, they actually said it's from one of the creators of Friends. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, all right. Yeah, I mean, I didn't really have name recognition with her until after... They had said that. I'm like, oh, okay, here we go. But, I mean, I like Friends. I don't know what the other guy has done. I've never watched anything, as far as I know.
He's only created a couple, and I think he wrote quite a few Friends and Veronica's Closet episodes. Because she also created that one.
That makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I hope, I mean, if they do another collaboration, I think I'd definitely check it out, for sure.
Agreed.
Sure.
I see. We have strong feelings. How does Grace and Frankie compare to other TV shows, including sitcoms or other Netflix original shows?
Easily more progressive.
Better.
Just in the topics that the show handles compared to what else is on TV right now, it's tackling a lot of issues in a very natural way for me.
And I will just kind of, I'll agree with that completely. I think it's smarter. A lot of things that are on TV, and where it is a sitcom, it isn't super tropey, which is nice and refreshing. It's amazing how many shows still rely on things like that compared to other Netflix shows. Netflix doesn't do a ton by way of comedic material, at least that I've watched, but I could be wrong. It seems a lot of dramas and superhero stuff, so I think it kind of stands alone in that regard.
I think, I mean, I've touched upon why I think that this show stands out and in comparison to some of the other material that's out there, not in any better or worse way, but in its own way, just by presenting stories and in a comedic format and telling a narrative that is not readily available on any other network that I've seen, at least not in this way. And I agree. It's very smart. I think it has a ton of potential. So I'm a fan. And I think that they were very smart in their approach to this series.
Yeah, I agree. I think this also showed Netflix that, you know, even though this was targeted for an older demographic than the, you know, the big coveted, you know, the 18 to 49 or whatever, it was skewed slightly older and they still got that wide range appeal. And so hopefully they'll kind of take that as a, okay, here we go. And maybe they will try to make more comedies that will appeal to a wider audience.
I think Grace and Frankie definitely does have that appeal. And I also think that it is in many ways fresh. It isn't super tropey. There are still some, but it is a different way to present a sitcom. I like the fact that they don't pull any punches. They don't hold back any language. You know, that's part of the nifty thing about being on Netflix. They can say whatever they pretty much want, short of NC-17, I guess. And I think the fact that it's kind of, it's honest, genuine, I think that's unusual. I mean, some people in this panel have used the word realistic, but I would actually go as far as genuineness. I think there's a real connection that the writers have to the material, that the actors have to the material, and it's presenting what it is like to be these types of people in the world that we have today. And I think there are TV shows that are always going to try that. I think this one does it pretty successfully and does it in a way that's not so ham-fisted. You think to yourself, man, this is just ham and cheese on rye, and I can't stand it. So, and it is. It's pretty fresh, and, you know, I didn't answer the other question. Obviously, I've watched Friends. I don't know that I would necessarily motivate to watch based on just Grace and Frankie because of the combination of people, but I think that they would at least spark my interest for the future, for sure. Are you going to keep watching?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Of course you are, because we're going to talk about seasons 3 and 4 somewhat shortly, one might say. But I can't leave this without asking you, would you recommend Grace and Frankie to others? Why or why not?
Yes.
100%. Yes. To the right people.
100%. Yeah.
I wouldn't recommend it to people who are super conservative. They may get a little offended by the yam lube, but if they have a good sense of humor, I say for sure.
I agree with Kristen.
Okay.
It has to be the right. My parents would not like this show because of all of the bad words and things.
See, and I think my mom needs to watch this show like yesterday.
Me too.
So I'm not sure my dad would really get it as much, but yeah, I think with anything you recommend, you're always thinking, who can I recommend this to who would appreciate it and who would understand it? So I never even factor in whether or not it's a certain person. The answer is yes. That's how I approach it. And I have recommended it to people. People of all ages have been like, yeah, I love this show, for whatever their personal reasons are.
What I would like to do at this time is to thank Amie, Krista, Kristen, and Samantha for joining me to talk about the first 2 seasons of Grace and Frankie, and because I thank them in such a way, I now have to say this next thing in such a way, which goes like this. CPU was produced by Back Pocket Productions, run by yours truly, the Chief Couch Potato, and hails from Grand Rapids, Michigan. Please, if you like what you hear, take the time to rate us on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Google Play. That means give us stars, comments, reviews. Tell the others how we're doing. Tell them what you like. Tell them what you don't. Tell them what we should change, because we're open to that, people. We really are. If you have suggestions and shows we might consider, contact us at our website, couchpotatosunite.wordpress.com, via email at couchpotatosunitepodcast@gmail.com, or via Facebook and Twitter, though, of course, we add new and old shows to chat about around the water cooler all the time. We have several more new episodes coming down the pike, always. If you miss the old episodes, you want to know what we cover, just find us. Google search us. We top it under our name, and I consider that an A1 accomplishment. Subscribe to at our website, our channels, our social media accounts. Stay up on the new events and episodes. Until the next time, all available seasons of Grace and Frankie are available to stream on Netflix. They have not given us our free subscriptions. I've been meaning to have a talk about that because we constantly mention their name, but I guess that also means they put out good TV. In the meantime, our Grace and Frankie panel will next reconvene very shortly, in fact, to talk seasons 3 and 4 and part 2 of our 2-part catch-up miniseries. So, until the next episode, new episodes are published every Wednesday. Keep listening, keep watching, stay tuned!
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.